Welcome to the first lecture in the Stanford COVID-19 lecture series. I am Dr. David Hao.
And I'm Dr. Mahadevan, and we will be giving you an introduction to COVID-19 based on the currently available data.
We will review key signs and symptoms, discuss the spectrum of illness, and walk through the clinical course. After this lecture, you will learn how COVID-19 is transmitted, including asymptomatic spread and multiplying growth. Recognize at-risk populations, identify key signs and symptoms.
And you'll be able to define the spectrum of illness, which can range from asymptomatic to severe, describe the typical course of illness, and understand that patients may have atypical presentations.
COVID-19 is likely spread via coughing, sneezing, or even talking and breathing, producing respiratory droplets that typically travel less than 2 meters. And can remain in the air or land on surfaces. Individuals can acquire the infection by inhaling the viral particles or touching contaminated surfaces. Be aware that the disease can be spread even before symptoms appear.
Infectious particles, which are invisible to the naked eye, can be on any surface, such as door handles, sides of gurneys, keyboards, and floors.
Remember that the infection can spread after contaminating your hands and then touching one's face.
One person infects 2 to 3 people. This is the R0, or basic reproduction number of the virus. What this means is that one infected person can potentially trigger an infection of over 6,000 people within weeks.
This R0 is significantly larger than seasonal influenza, which means that COVID-19 is more easily transmitted from person to person. An important point is that the R0 can be reduced with public health interventions, such as physical distancing, mask wearing, and hand washing. Ultimately, the most important intervention will be providing vaccinations to as many people as possible. In South Korea, a woman, patient 31, went to a church with contacts of over 1,000 people. Incubation can take up to 14 days before symptom onset. Most patients develop symptoms around 4 days after exposure. This is different than seasonal influenza, where patients can suddenly develop symptoms within hours of exposure.
However, patients can be infectious before they develop symptoms, or they may never develop symptoms. This may lead to significant silent spread of the disease.
The case fatality rate for COVID-19 infections varies from 0.7% to 7.2% based on early reports.
The true case fatality rate will remain unknown until we are able to do more widespread testing, because it depends on the total number of cases that are detected. And variants may have different case fatality rates.
Like all viruses, COVID-19 mutates over time. While most mutations do not affect viral function, some variants identified have either become the dominant type in a region or have significant clinical concern with increased transmission and severity.
The WHO has identified several dominant variants of concern, and there are more variants of interest and potentially emerging variants of concern. But the WHO will continue to track them with global partners.
Older patients are at most risk for complications and death.
Other risk factors for more serious disease and complications include cancer, cerebrovascular disease, chronic kidney disease, chronic lung disease, diabetes, heart disease, obesity, pregnancy, and smoking.
Not all patients with COVID-19 will develop symptoms. In Iceland, a large population was tested. 50% of people that tested positive had no symptoms.
And not all patients will develop a severe illness. Many will recover without knowing that they had the infection, while others, especially those with risk factors, will be at significant risk of severe illness.
About 81% of patients will develop a mild infection around day 4. These patients may have an influenza-like illness with fever, cough, and sore muscles. They may also have loss of taste and/or smell.
However, about 14% of all cases go on to develop a severe illness around day 9. These patients will complain of shortness of breath, and they typically have a severe pneumonia with more than 50% of their lung involved. As a result, they suffer from hypoxemia, which is a lack of oxygen in their vital tissues and bloodstream.
And approximately 5% of all patients will become critically ill around day 12. These patients will develop respiratory failure and often require ventilatory support. Some will develop shock and multi-organ dysfunction. Some will die, while others may recover. A subsequent lecture will discuss the specifics of risk stratification.
The average time for recovery for mild cases is about 2 weeks, and for severe cases, it may take as long as 3 to 6 weeks.
Although not fully understood, other complications beyond respiratory complications have been identified.
Inflammatory complications are similar to cytokine release syndrome, although less severe. Multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children, or MIS-C, is similar to Kawasaki syndrome and has been described in children in rare cases.
Cardiovascular complications range from having no symptoms to arrhythmias, myocardial injury, heart failure, and cardiogenic shock.
Deep venous thrombosis and pulmonary embolism are common, affecting up to 1/3 of ICU patients in some reports.
Neurologic complications present primarily as encephalopathy, especially in ICU patients, and some patients report persistent symptoms for weeks to months.
Secondary bacterial infections can occur, but are not common.
In summary, COVID-19 is highly transmissible, with exponential growth enabling it to rapidly spread all over the world. Risk factors for severe disease are mainly advanced age and underlying chronic medical conditions.
Although most cases are mild or asymptomatic, emergent variants of concern have the potential to become more transmissible and severe. Respiratory complications are the main complications of COVID-19, but other complications have been identified as well.
Important public health interventions include physical distancing, mask wearing, and hand washing. Ultimately, the most important intervention will be providing vaccinations to as many people as possible.
The latter lectures will describe the clinical management of COVID-19. Thank you for joining us in fighting the COVID-19 pandemic. We hope that this was helpful. Stay healthy and stay safe.